So let's take a look at the codex here. I don't know what Valroyo is, so maybe if we learn a little bit more about it, everything that's happening here might make a little bit more sense. So let's look for Valroyo in here. Valroyo. Valroyo, any resident, a Royan, will say it is the greatest city in the world. Many take such pride for arrogance, but they do so through smiles as they nod in agreement, for such is the cost of doing business in the capital. Valroyeaux is in every way a world leader in commerce, culture, and its own exaggerated beauty. The site was founded during Envrion's grand unification, the result of a mix of influences not so much balanced as driven together. And while such an amalgamation would be cause for chaos elsewhere, the prosperity of the region has enabled an upward spiral of indulgence. The capital has endured the ages to become a beacon of civilization, and its citizens the measure of modernity. Just ask them. An element of Valroyeaux is notoriously risque, and it exists harmoniously beside the aristocracy, and the palace bureaucrats. Indeed, the aristocracy tends to indulge in the city's darker side quite frequently, if discreetly, and that only adds to the mystique. Nobility elsewhere tend to be much more conservative and concerned about their reputation, even if a trip into the capital to indulge a few private pleasures is not completely out of the question. In Valroyeaux, transgressions are suffered and forgiven with flamboyant urgency. That is not to say the city is without lasting scandal and hardship, but one must squint past the gilding to be allowed even a glimpse, as Royans are very careful about the face they present. Such it is with the masks of nobility and the underbelly of their streets. Excerpted from Valroyeaux, Excess Grand and Otherwise by formerly Sister Laudine. Okay, so Valroyeaux is the capital, it's the biggest city, everybody thinks it's awesome and great. I want to know a little bit more about that dude whose name I already forgot, and I'm hoping I'll see it here show up. Him, right? This guy. This is the guy that punched the speaker person there. For months, we were all so certain Lord Seeker Lambert's death was an assassination. Death? What? Is this the wrong person? I thought his name was Lucius. This is him, right? Oh, I'm talking about Lambert. But I tell you. For months, we were all so certain Lord Seeker Lambert's death was an assassination carried out by mages. He had, after all, declared the Navarran Accord null and void, hurtling us headlong into a war against the rebels. Why else would he be killed except as an act of retribution? The entire Templar Order was fired up, ready to take up the fight against the mages. Something we were sure would be over in a matter of weeks. Thus, the election of Lucius Corin to the role made me despair. According to the few seekers of truth with whom I spoke, he was a moderate. He agreed to the Divine's conclave, and every Templar I knew felt certain he would compromise to see the war ended. But lately, the man seems different, does he not? I never met him before he assumed command, but even in this short time, his opinions on the war have turned. He did not go to the conclave he personally supported. In fact, he seems to regret supporting it at all. He talks of the Templars establishing themselves as a power in our own right, and our fellows are all too eager to listen. I don't know from where this change of heart came, but I begin to wonder if Lambert's death wasn't as simple a matter as we assumed. Something is amiss within our order, and all I know is that it's beyond me to discover that. To discover what? From a letter written by an unknown Templar found in a burned-out fort, 941 Dragon. Okay. Who else can we learn about here? Who's this? Okay, so there's nothing about this woman we were just speaking to. All right. Well, so something's going on with old Lucius, obviously. There's no question about that. Okay, what kind of missions do we have here in, nothing in Valroyeaux? What? Huh. Champion of the Just. So I can't do anything about that one yet. This mission here, we just simply return to Haven's Chantry. The Inner Circle. A friend of Red Jenny, the strange message delivered via arrow, said there is an enemy of the Inquisition waiting to strike in Val Royeaux. It's said to search the market, cafe, and docks for things that are red. The upper market can be reached by way of the quest map. Search by the docks, search in the cafe, search in the upper market. And then the Imperial Enchanter, Vivian Defer, the first enchanter of Montsimard, has extended an invitation to her salon at the chateau of Duke Bastien de Gislaine. Let's take a look here. Let's see. Anything showing up on the map here? Let's see. There's something this way. Something over here. I think it's this direction. Let's go back here and see what this business is. Examine. Is this it? Difficult time for those who have lost. While I understand concerns for propriety and the general dressing of the bazaar, I must caution that release is needed. We are suffering not just ongoing civil conflict pitting brother against sister, not just outright war pitting Templar against mage, not just the loss of our most holy and the best of our leaders. We are suffering all three as the sky is wounded for all to see. All we know of our world is threatened, along with all we know of the next. With this most grave notation, I ask that the writs of losses and missing remain, that the citizens, however indirectly, be allowed to post their griefs of known dead and the names of hopefully living, and with them their criticisms of how they have been told or not told. For while I have no doubt we as Orlesians will maintain our utmost composure, there must be release, there must be grief, there must be mourning. If not, if we do not allow this simple expression, we risk a greater outburst. Let our people shed their tears in as reserved a means as necessary. The market will be cleared in due course, but this day, this time, we must let this simple expression stand. Written by Captain Albion, Orlesian Guard, Summer Bazaar. Okay.
I walk only where you would bid me, stand only in places you have blessed, sing only the words you place in my throat.
That was beautiful, dude. Something red. Hey, look, there's something red on the ground over there.
Let's look around.
Reservoir stocking evaluation. Tremors, floating, taste is off, water birds die off, restocking failed, fish not fit, do not consume. Once again, I say... Okay. What's making that noise? Red handkerchief. Favors for favors for friends. A red handkerchief folded around a key with a small hasty scrawl. Key lifted from drunk swearing about Harold. Don't know what door. I'm out. My debt is paid. Okay. Alright. Oh, good. Something else to read. Mirror de la Mer reveals folly. Mirror de la Mer was cut from Val Royeaux in 849 Blessed. It was the will of the mad Emperor Reville, who demanded a reflecting pool large enough to draw his vain deceased mother back across the veil. Many shops and vendors were evicted to make room for his folly, and several memorials to the heroes of the first four blights were simply toppled. The reservoir supports little in the way of life, as the bottom was lined with lead to increase its reflective properties. Reville intended it for divination using boats as massive planchettes, but work was not finished until the week of his own death. The waters see little use today, save for lazy or fornication, sojourns by the nobility aboard decorative gondolas, excerpted and torn from a disposable walking tour of the capital by Philemon Bard.
When there was no sky maker, you were the sky. When there was no earth, you were the earth. When there was nothing, you were everything.
Preach it. Okay, so we got one of the red Jenny things. Can I go up these steps? Nothing in there, or at least I can't open the door to find out. Get up already, you're fine. Man. Alright, apparently there's something in this direction, so let's go down here and see if we can find the next red Jenny thing. What do you have to say?
They say a lot about you. Can't believe
just don't give me a reason, heretics.
All right, shut up. Oh, goody, another thing to read. La Masse du Lion. We cheered when honored was her might, but many more deserve a thought. For though she was the first a knight, her kin and kind have always fought. What? From a plaque with a dedication, La Masse du Lion, sponsored by Princess Corin's first cavalry for those we stood beside. Fascinating. Read. Knot of heroes, Mafirath and sacrifice, Andraste, our lady, the sword and the fire against Vinter, betrayed to the Empire in exchange for a kingdom. Mafirath, now synonymous with treachery. But would Andraste have won, and if not, what would we have lost? Let us look not just at the act, but at the why of it. As the armies of faith pierced the Imperial homeland, it was revealed not as a wave, but as an arrow. And as any hunter will attest, if your aim is not true, there is no returning to the bow. We must consider how much of Our Lady's victory to this point was against true Imperium, and how much was against the echoes of Empire. Andraste, the inspiration, may not have considered such. But Mafirath, the general, fought for homeland, not visions. Was it victory or defeat that his betrayal held at bay? Mafirath made the deal that killed Our Lady, that is fact. And when Andraste died, Mafirath was gifted everything from the southern plains south. How generous and impossible to hold this must have seemed. Let us look on Mafirath and the legacy he divided among his sons, not with an eye for accusation, but from a tactical consideration. For he must have known that mere rivals had never stopped to Vinter. What if he set about creating peers, and none of this was accident? How then fared Issaroth and Embrion and Verald? Blah, 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 blah. Okay, that was really very enlightening. Here is something on the ground here. A red handkerchief. Favors for favors for friends. A different simple script on the back of a stable report, marked with red paint. Thank you, friends, for helping good Lady Karis. Saw those who asked about Harold enter third passages, could not stay to see them exit. Third passage. Find me. What? What? Huh? For someone...
Do we?
Can you... What? Guide me? What is this stuff? To the revolt inside me?
And you?
What the... I don't know what the heck's going on. Okay, can't go in there. So, supposedly, what does this mean? Where am I now on this map? Yeah, search the upper market. Okay. How do I get to the upper market? What the heck does this mean? Oh, okay, so this means show me where my goal is and show me where I am. Unfortunately, I don't know where this is in relation to where I am now. No, sir, I don't know. Here's some steps. What the? Oh, okay.
Blessed are the righteous, the lights in the shadow, in their blood.
Something more to read. Knot of heroes, the death of diversity. What could hold back an empire? Another. What could hold back so defined a people as Teventer? Another. Let us consider if Eldus Isarath was not meant to honor Mafirath, for the father's fate was already condemned by hidden betrayal. Let us consider that Isarath was told to turn from ties to Mafirath to look forward, not back. What of his actions then? Isarath was granted a land of tribes of scattered alliance. His answer was the grand unification, which most condemn as arrogance. Sweeping changes in trade, relocations to break local allegiances, all to favor centralized trade and power. Cities were leveled to expand a new capital, a powerful and influential city of a new nation, Val Royeaux of Orlais. And all in the name of not Lost Andraste, but of holding back looming Teventer. Power was united, but cultures less so. Investing everyone in the new Orlais stratified the classes, and through it all spread a bitterness that a Ferelden ruled. Isarath avoided the stain of his father, for he was seen as victim too, but he was still Alamari. What if, dear readers, the final unifying element came not from accident, or even the deliberate actions of Isarath, but from a common hatred, and not the common hatred of the day? The sons of Maferath would succeed at creating a peer for Teventer, but only at the cost of themselves.